some years ago, I was as young as you. I wish, when I was young, I wish to see small things that eyes cannot see. And Professor Huber did just that the year that I was about entering a college, and then I learned about the word X-ray crystallography. The work that was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1988. None of you probably were born by then, 1988. He used X-ray diffraction, and then probably we all know about his achievement. But for today's work, Professor Huber will speak to all of the lucky students here at the Asian Science Camp on his half a century investigation of a topic that I'm most favorite on the protease regulation in biological system. And if you please give a big hand and welcome Professor Robert Huber to the stage.
Good afternoon. Do you understand me in the back? Well, thank you for your kind words. Thanks to all who were involved in the organization with the invitation to come here. I'm very pleased to see so many students. One of the reasons why I came was to perhaps lure one or the other of you into my field of research, which is structural biology, which plays a great role in modern pharmacology and drug design. I would like to lead you through this field, first beginning with the history of X-ray crystallography, structural chemistry, and molecular biology, and then show you with many examples of what we can learn from this kind of research. So the first slide is showing in three parts the birth document of molecular structural chemistry, the birth document of X-ray crystallography, which was the first method to have views of at atomic resolution of chemical molecules and later then of biological macromolecules. It's the diffraction of X-rays by a crystal. Not a nice view, as you can see, just some smeared spots on a photographic film, yet it meant a revolution because this simple experiment first showed that X-rays are electromagnetic radiation, which are diffracted by crystals, of course, proving that crystals are three-dimensional lattices. And later then, the information that one gains from these diffraction patterns was used to visualize at atomic resolution molecules. Now this is the person who did that experiment, and its interpretation was Max von Laue, a physicist at the Ludwig Maximilians University in Munich, where he worked together with Röntgen side by side. Röntgen was the professor of experimental physics, and Laue was with Sommerfeld, who was a professor of theoretical physics. Laue's publication in 1912, June, Nobel Prize for this work was given 2 years later, 1940. Publication in the Berichte der Bayerischen Akademie der Wissenschaften, a journal that still exists. Few read it, impact factor very low, but worth a Nobel Prize, as you can see. And this is Laue at one of the very early Lindau meetings of Nobel laureates, showing to the founder of the Lindau meetings of Nobel laureates, Count Bernadotte, a crystal lattice. It's a wonderful occasion for students to meet Nobel laureates. This year it was more than 60 who came there, 700 students from all over the world. So apply and ask your mentors to recommend your applications. I miss Thai students there. There could be more, I think, to attend these yearly meetings. Now, these are the four founding fathers of crystallography and then later protein crystallography. This is Röntgen, who discovered the X-rays. As I said, he worked at the time of Laue's discovery in Munich. The key experiment of Laue, diffraction of X-rays by crystals, was communicated very quickly around the world to England, where father and son, this is son, Lawrence Bragg, worked. And they immediately grasped the importance of Laue's experiments for determining crystal structures, very simple ones. First, sodium chloride, just a cubic arrangement of chloride anions and sodium cations. Now, this then showed that it is possible to determine atomic structures of crystals and then of molecules, of course, which crystallize. And this, they founded a school in Cambridge, England, which, by the way, produced more Nobel laureates than any other science research location in the world. The foundation of molecular biology was there, and a founding father was Max Perutz, who discovered a way to analyze the complex diffraction patterns of proteins, which are, of course, much more complex than those of sodium chloride. So Perutz is the father of protein crystallography. Now, I continue to protein biological crystallography, and we note the exponential growth from its start. Its start was in the early 60s. There were just one or two or three protein structures had been determined. I entered the field in 68, and there was less than a handful of protein structures known at that time. Slow growth until about 1990, and then the exponential growth because of the technical advances. And because it was recognized that in order to understand biology, we must see the molecules. And then in the last 15, 20 years came applications to medicine and biotechnology, which I would like to describe then in the last part of my presentation. Well, there was a problem with crystallization of proteins, which exists still now. And in particular, a problem with membrane proteins, but was well recognized that membrane proteins are essential in biology, and about 30% of proteins are embedded in membranes, so they are water insoluble. for isolation, they need detergent and some quite tricky preparation procedures to get pure material. And they are physiologically, particularly important. So we, that was Deisenhofer, myself, and Michel, all three working at the Max Planck Institute of Biochemistry. I'll show a few pictures of that institute later. Thought this would be an interesting project. Now, I and my group, Deisenhofer was a member of, we had developed the techniques, the crystallographic techniques to analyze very large protein molecules. So we were lucky to crystallize a integral membrane protein, namely the photosynthetic reaction center from a purple bacterium, in crystals that are highly ordered and give a beautiful diffraction pattern. This work was published in 85, and a Nobel Prize was given for that work 3 years later. Now, there's relatively slow progress in membrane protein crystallography for about 10 years, but now we read almost every second week in the top journals about membrane protein crystal structures. Nobel Prizes have been given for that. I think after the photosynthetic reaction center, it was three more Nobel Prizes for membrane proteins. The last one for membrane protein crystal structure, the last one was for the GPCR, beta-2 adrenergic G protein coupled receptor to Lefkowitz and Kobielka in 2012. I mean, these are also people that you meet in Lindau. They were both present in Lindau this year in June. Well, this just a brief view of our work on the photosynthetic reaction center and the excitement that that structure caused, not only because it was the first integral membrane protein showing how that part of the protein is integrated in the membrane. What is the secondary structure, the tertiary structure? You see it's all alpha helical. Membrane part is here. And not less important, it showed how sunlight is converted into an electric current by a series of chlorophylls, which are embedded in the protein matrix. So here is a special pair of chlorophylls, which is the primary acceptor of excitation, of light excitation energy that comes in from the outside, from light harvesting protein pigment complexes, excites this structures such that it ejects an electron, which then travels down a chain of chlorophylls to reduce the quinone. This is the primary step of photosynthesis, and that happens in the picosecond range, so very fast. So of course, the physicists were interested in how it comes that there is electron transfer in organic material. What are the structural requirements? And we are quite far in understanding now in basic theoretical terms how this special arrangement of chlorophylls can conduct electrons very, very fast. Now, this was at the ceremony in 1988. Both the King and I were substantially younger at that time. Back to my institute, which was inaugurated in 72 in the Munich area, an institute in the forest, as you can see. These are the outskirts of Munich. farm, land, and wood forest around it. And this is how it looked when we moved in. So a flock of sheep grazing there. And therefore, the institute, which is located in Martin's Reed, was called Martin's Rue, which means a quiet place for Martin. And you see, it was not really quiet inside. There was a group of, there was a large institute, still a large institute, with 12 directors, 12 departments at that time. Some famous people, this is Adolf Butenandt, Nobel laureate in chemistry for his work on the structure of human sexual hormones. And this is Theodor Lünen, a Nobel laureate in medicine for his work on fatty acid synthesis. Some of you by name may know Per Edman from the Edman degradation. So this is the method how still now proteins are sequenced from the N-terminus. And there is a young guy here sitting on the left-hand side. Well, this is how Martin's Reed and the campus looks like right now. What you saw first was the Max Planck Institute of Biochemistry. Now to it was added another Max Planck Institute of Neurobiology, and then came an innovation center, which is an incubator, and I come back to that later, how important this may be, and a substantial number of university institutes were added. It's a big campus with about 10,000 people, which I think is one of the keys for the successful research in that area, to be close distance, to share instruments and share ideas. I now come to the subject of my presentation, proteins and proteases and their control. This is the life cycle of proteins. Now, no proteins are made on the ribosome. Ada Jonath will speak, and she will talk in detail on the structure and function of the ribosome. It emerges as an unfolded polypeptide, then in a mysterious step that we still don't understand, it folds up into a well-defined three-dimensional structure. However, proteins are sensitive, and they lose function and structure upon any kind of stress, temperature, pH, pressure, what have you. So they are losing their function, they are waste material, and they have to be removed, and that happens by peptidases. They cleave the protein. You know, the proteins consist of a chain of amino acids. They cleave the unfolded functionless proteins into the constituent amino acids, which are then recycled and reused. Well, the problem with proteases is that they are very dangerous. You see, if they are left uncontrolled, they would digest the proteins in the cells, the essential proteins in cells and outside cells. So protease regulation is absolutely essential. And this is what I worked on since the late 60s, early 70s, until now, also because of the importance of protease regulation for pharmacology and drug design. Now, what this scheme here shows is what we had discovered in these more than 40 years of research on protease and their regulation, the ways how in nature protease activity is regulated. There is a very simple first mechanism of regulation that we discovered in the early 70s, that there is a small protein which binds to the substrate binding to the active site of the protease very tightly, much more tightly than the substrate itself does. So this complex then is inactive because substrate cannot access, cannot bind to the protease. Let me show this very first example that we saw. This is trypsin, the digestive enzyme, prototype chymotrypsin, many others. All the blood clotting enzymes belong to the trypsin family. So this we analyzed in its free state. And then there is a small proteinaceous inhibitor shown in blue, which we also analyzed in its free state. And then we made the complex and looked at the structure of the complex and found that there is perfect fit. You already can see here that the surfaces of both molecules are extremely rugged. So protein surfaces are usually very asymmetric. Yet these two molecules are made for each other. And this is the reason why there is very tight binding. There is no structural change. They are just made for each other. They have evolved for each other, with each other. Now, this kind of lock and key binding we found in all other major classes of proteinases. These are the trypsin-like proteinases. So the first example I just showed to you, we discovered many more natural trypsin protease inhibitors. They all interact in the same way. They have a perfectly complementary surface. Now these are the cysteine proteases, so papain, for instance, prototypical, also has, they have their natural inhibitors, and again they bind in a complementary way. Cystatin, for instance, which is a major constituent of bird's egg white. And the metalloproteinases. Again, they have their natural inhibitors, which are, as you can see here, larger than the protease they recognize. They bind in a specific way by sticking their N-terminus into the active site. Here is the active site sink. These are metalloproteinases, and this is the essential active site element. They embrace its target, so to say, and bind very tightly. Now, this was a key structure because of the role of metalloproteases in physiology and pathology. I just noted here the physiological processes where metalloproteinases, which all have a basic structure similar to what we saw here in metalloproteinase called stromalysin. They have their specific natural inhibitors. Now, the interest comes also because metalloproteinases play a role in pathological processes. You have a whole list. I don't think there are many basic pathologies where metalloproteinase does not come into play. So it's quite clear that they are in the focus of drug design, pharma research and drug design, with the aim to make small molecules that in a way simulate the binding mode of these natural proteinaceous inhibitors. The problem there is, despite enormous activity worldwide, is that these about 25 or 30 different metalloproteinases, which play different roles in pathologies, yet they look very similar. So to find specific compounds for specific inhibition of a particular metalloproteinase. So this is the problem people are working on right now. And of course, they base their work, their modeling, the modeling part of their work on the crystal structures that have been determined. Next mode of inhibition was that there are proteinases which are extremely specific. And in particular, the proteinases that have to do with blood coagulation. Again, blood coagulation enzymes are in the focus of drug design, very successful in cases, also an enormous economic success when one discovers a new blood coagulation small molecule inhibitor. Now, we were involved in that work, but we also looked at natural coagulation inhibitors, thrombin inhibitors. Now, thrombin is the terminal enzyme in the coagulation cascade. It's a trypsin-like protease, shown in blue here, that we determined, we analyzed structurally. We know where the specificity of thrombin is based on a very long binding surface where the substrate polypeptide binds to. So we looked at nature solution, and there are these blood-sucking animals. This is the leech. This is a blood-sucking bug, and this is the tick. They all have powerful coagulation enzyme inhibitors, in particular thrombin inhibitors. What we did is isolating them and determining the crystal structure. This is hirudoine in green, which is actually an approved anticoagulant drug by itself and has been chemically modified, hirulog, again on the basis of what we see in the structure, what we the most important signature of leech inhibitor of the hirudoine is this long C-terminal tail, which alone is able to bind quite tightly to thrombin, and this was then the basis of making hirulog, just using the tail and a small addition, a chemical substituent, made it. Proenzyme cleavage. Well, most of the proteases are made as inactive precursors. We can understand that, because if they would be active at the site of their synthesis, think of the pancreatic digestive enzymes, they would destroy and digest the pancreas if they were active. So they are made as inactive precursors, are then secreted, in the case of the pancreatic enzymes, into the digestive tract, are activated there and do their job. And how is that? Well, it's usually this kind of mechanism is found not only in the serine proteases on which I focused so far, but in all other enzyme classes, and usually such that the proenzyme, the precursor, has an additional part here, an N-terminal peptide of about 100 amino acids, which covers the active site, very simple. And then activation is by cleaving off this part and liberating the enzyme, very simple. But there are also cases where when this part is cleaved off, there is a rearrangement of the structure of the enzyme. And only this rearranged conformation then is enzymatically active. So we saw both situations. This is the simple one in carboxypeptidase. This is the pro part. This is the active site. And this is cleaved off, falls away, and the active site becomes accessible. The other mechanism where cleavage of the pro part leads to a major structural rearrangement we saw in the classical serine proteases. In trypsin itself, trypsinogen is the inactive form, so we crystallized trypsinogen and compared it to trypsin, the active form, and found a major structural change. Now here, the pro part is cleaved off, falls away, and the new N-terminus, which is made after, which is generated after cleavage, folds into the center of the molecule and leads to a drastic rearrangement of this part into a structure that is now able to bind substrate. So an allosteric trigger of the conformational change. Colocalization, another way of controlling protease activity, is to anchor protease to a membrane. And then, of course, this protease is only active on the surface of the membrane. So all the coagulation enzymes, thrombin, factor 10A, factor 9, factor 7, and so on, all of that kind, they have an enzyme part, which is usually trypsin-like, and they have a spacer, and they have a membrane anchor. We looked at many of these structures. This is factor 10A, which recently has become a blockbuster. Its inhibition has been found to be an excellent target to prevent blood coagulation, and Bayer, on the basis of the structure that we had determined, developed Xarelto, which is on the market and, as I said, already a blockbuster. Again, the importance of structure information was quite obvious here in this case. Cofactor binding. Now, there is regulation by a cofactor. So the enzyme in green is unable to bind the substrate without the help of an additional linker, of a linking, of a mediator, namely this cofactor, which adds an additional binding surface, you see. Now this we saw in an example where we analyzed the free enzyme, the binary and the ternary complex, and we found that there is no structural change. So it's the simple addition of binding sites which makes then the enzyme active. Without the cofactor, the substrate is not bound stably enough to be processed. But there is another case that we found some years ago where the cofactor binding causes allosterically a structural change in the enzyme. And only this structure changed enzyme then is able to process. And this we found in a quite interesting case, namely the staphylococcus. Now, staphylococci are very dangerous if not treated in time. And they are dangerous because they cause in the bloodstream disseminated coagulation in a very short time. And how do they do that? They secrete a virulence factor, which is called staphylococcus. And this then binds to the inactive proform of thrombin in such a way, as we have shown by structure, that it sticks its N-terminus into the site which normally in thrombin is occupied by its own N-terminus in irreversible activation, as I have shown in the case of trypsin. So you see how staphylococcus embraces its target and sticks its N-terminus into that site. Now, we had called that many, many years ago, before knowing that structure, when we discussed a possible mechanism of serine protease activation, we called this mechanism molecular sexuality. And it took 20 years until we found an example that this is actually the case. Now, substrate access. This is a system which I'm working on since 15 years. These are the large intracellular proteases, here the proteasome, and they showed a very unusual and novel regulatory mechanism. These are very large molecules. They consist of 28 subunits. They have their active sites inside and not accessible because the particle is closed, so substrate cannot enter. Regulation is by opening the entry port. And of course, we wanted to know how these molecules look like, in particular because of their major role. The proteasome, this is the name of this intracellular protease, plays in the ubiquitination pathway. Some of you, I hope most of you, know about ubiquitination and its role. It was honored with a Nobel Prize in some years ago to Hershko, Chikanova, and Rose. They discovered this ubiquitination cascade, which labels proteins that are going to be degraded. So proteins that do have a short lifetime in cells need to be removed. So for instance, all the cyclins, the cell cycle controlling proteins, they have a short lifetime. And they are labeled with polyubiquitin and then recognized by the proteasome and degraded. So this is a major role of the proteasome. There is no cell cycle without proteasome. Now, the proteasome is also the major waste cleaner. So denatured proteins that are around in cells are recognized as denatured, unfolded by the proteasome and are degraded into octapeptides. And this is essential for immunology. If this is a foreign protein, so a viral or a bacterial protein in a cell, then these products of the proteasome degradation are antigenic, are transferred to the cell surface in complex with MHC class I molecules, and this leads to the T cell immune response. There is no T cell immune response without proteasome, so a very essential molecule. Now, we determined the first structure in of the proteasome in 95, and then the eukaryotic one. This was from an archibacterium, a wonderful example of evolution. The archibacteria do have a molecule with an architecture which is very similar, as you can see, to that of yeast and mammalia. Also consists of 28 subunits, 7 alpha, 7 beta, 7 beta, 7 alpha, but all the alphas are identical. Now in eukaryotes, all the alphas are different. So during evolution, there is preservation of the major architecture. There is preservation of the major enzymatic mechanism and the major regulatory mechanism, but there is diversity generated in the subunits. These alpha 1 to alpha 7, of course, all look similar, but they differ in perhaps 20 or 30% of the amino acids and have different functions, different functional roles. So this is how evolution works. I come to another example perhaps later. Well, this I skip. Now, when we had in our hands the first proteasome structure, it turned out to be a novel kind of protease, namely a threonine protease. Then there was an enormous activity in proteasome research. Then an American company discovered, of course, making use of our published proteasome crystal structure, when they discovered that the proteasome is offers a novel strategy against the blood cancer, namely multiple myeloma. They discovered a simple chemical, this boronate, which has a boronic acid here, which binds to the N-terminal threonin, which I mentioned as a novel active site, and developed it. Now, this commercial success then spurred the research in that field enormously. Hundreds of researchers and companies were then trying to find other proteasome inhibitors and were successful in screening natural compound libraries. So many of these compounds they found were sent to us to determine the structure of how they are bound. This is a very small collection, but what you see in yellow is proteasome inhibitors from natural compound libraries. They all bind to the N-terminal threonin, but in different ways. This is an aldehyde group, which chemists know make an acetal with a hydroxyl group of the threonin. These are the unsaturated amide bonds, which react by a Michael addition with the N-terminal threonin. These are this omuralide is a lactone, which also acylates and opens the ring with the N-terminal threonin, and so on and so forth. So all of these have been discovered. We had analyzed their structures, and then synthesis have been made to make variants and check whether they are can be used for further development and eventual commercialization. So many have been found. This is just a list of chemical entities that have been discovered in the search for proteasome inhibitors. this is a very nice example of showing how plant research and pharmacology can come together. Now, these colleagues from Zurich have found that this plant pathogen, which kills bean plants, needs a virulence factor, which they isolate, which looks like this. Now, we found what it does is it binds to the proteasome, forms a covalent bond with the N-terminal threonine, Michael addition I mentioned already. And what it does in the plant cells, this leads, incubation with this molecule leads to the accumulation of cyclin B1 ubiquitin conjugates and to the arrest of the cell cycle into apoptosis and finally then to the death of these bean plant leaves. Well, what we are working on right now primarily is on a variant of the proteasome. So the constitutive proteasome, as I mentioned, has been found to be a important target for some forms of multiple myeloma. Very important, that's a $1 billion business. However, it turns out that it shows a very high toxicity against nerve cells, and a large proportion of the patients need to stop treatment with this proteasome inhibitor because of the serious neurotoxicity. So now, it was known that immune cells do have a slightly different form of the proteasome called the immune proteasome. Its crystal structure showed that it was from mouse compared to mouse constitutive proteasome. It showed that the molecules are very, very similar. There are only three subunits which are exchanged, namely those that are responsible for the enzymatic activity and the specificity. Slight change, just a few amino acids. Yet these changes lead to a somewhat higher activity of the immune proteasome compared to the constitutive proteasome and to a somewhat different specificity. So specifically, the immune proteasome makes more of the peptides that are triggering, that are binding to MHC class 1 molecules and triggering the T cell immune response. Well, what we thought is if we were able to inhibit the immune proteasome specifically, not touching the constitutive proteasome, we may avoid the neurotoxicity. So we set up a program to develop immune-specific proteasome inhibitors. And then this is already work that goes beyond what an academic group can do. And we found some help, and just show a few slides for of that. Now, this cartoon shows the general problem of basic research and its translation into commercial development. It's called the development gap or the valley of death. Now, what can you do? You see, there are the discoverers, the basic researchers. They are absolutely convinced of the importance of their finding, And they do not really understand that there is little interest on the industrial, the commercial side. And the commercial side doesn't understand that the basic researchers do not accept that the industry side needs already, has to earn money, would like to have projects at a stage, at a more developed stage. So the idea was of the Max Planck Society, that is the research institution I work in, to have a organization that takes up ideas from basic research, mostly from Max Planck researchers, develops them further, and then brings them to a stage where they become, these ideas become interesting for industry. So this, I was able to convince this lead discovery center of the Max Planck Society. They took up the idea, and then some basic research, which is reported on this busy slide. For those who are interested, they may look at this PNAS publication. It's structural biology, which told us about a principal requirement of specific inhibitors for the immune proteasome. A principal requirement that is not fulfilled by the constitutive proteasome. So, of course, directing the search for immune proteasome inhibitors in a specific direction, which was quite successful, so successful that Big Pharma became interested. That was Merck in Darmstadt, and now there is a co-development and a cooperation between the Lead Discovery Center, myself, and Merck. Now this is a last novel mechanism that we discovered by structural biology of regulating protease activity, and I just leave it with that cartoon, which I hope is explaining the mechanism sufficiently. Well, there are proteases which are called DEC or HTRA. They are ubiquitous. They occur in bacteria and in plants, in yeast, in humans, what have you. They do have a protease part, and they do have a PDC domain. Now, these PDC domains are well-known domains of about 120 amino acids, which bind C-terminal parts of other proteins. So they are entities that are often used in different protein systems to mediate protein-protein interaction. Well, now what did we find? Now we found that in the absence of substrate, the protease is inactive, and the PDC domain, which is, as I said, a module that binds C-terminal parts of other proteins for protein-protein interaction, is empty. When a substrate comes, this is an OMP, but it doesn't matter, then this C-terminal part of the OMP binds to the PDC domain, and that leads allosterically to a structural change in the protease part, which now adopts an active conformation. But not only that, it also leads to aggregation. So this is a trimer, and this is a 20-former, and it forms a shell around its substrate. It encapsulates its substrate. Now, we do have structures of all of these and found what happens, what triggers the formation of the capsule from the smaller oligomer, which is inactive while the capsule is active. This was a novel kind of activation by substrate binding. And now in the last few minutes, I would like to come to what has been announced in the title, translation, my experience in translation into medicine and pharmacological application. So I thought in the late 90s that we have accumulated so much information on the technology, on the methods of protein structure determination that we should make use of it. And I found a postdoc who had been with me for some time who was interested in this idea, and so we started founding a company, first a few people. I should say that I personally never had anything to do with the operational business. I was helping, supporting, advising, but not in the operation. So this has now grown to 70 people. It's located in Munich. They have their own laboratory building, or writing black numbers, which is very important for a biotech company, and they live on their services. So they have service for big pharma to determine, make target proteins of interest for big pharma, and determining structures of ligands that have been developed by big pharma, and they are more recent in the last 10 years also involved in lead discovery itself. So they choose a certain interesting target and try to find a lead for that. Well, this is what they are doing, from protein production, structure analysis to screening, and so on and so forth. But they essentially live on the services. So they did not need an investor because they grew with the incoming money from the customers. Well, I skip these. Well, they have a long list of interesting target proteins which are on the shelf. That is, they have protein, clean protein material for assay or for crystallization purposes, and even crystals in the refrigerator. So if a customer comes and says, I have a new inhibitor for the kinase MEK2, and I would like to know how it binds, then he will get an answer within a month or so, because all the processes of structure determination have been established. Now, of interest here is what, because they have an international customer, what you see here from this list is what the primary interest of pharma companies is, what kind of structures of molecules are they working on. It's mostly kinases, it's proteases, and some others. So it is those proteins that are still in the focus of drug design and drug research. So they not only sell structures, but they also sell proteins, and they make assays. Now the last 5 minutes is on a second company which I co-founded with three former postdoctoral students, Jakob Sondermann, in 2003, and the heading says that very recently, just half a year ago, it made investors, lawyers, and broker, and the founders quite happy. And let me tell you that story. Now it goes back to our antibody work in the middle 70s, when we determined the first structure of IgGs. It is these famous Y-shaped molecules that you see in textbooks, where we determined the crystal structure from you. The antigens are bound to the tips of these molecules. This is where the most variable regions are located to provide specificity for all possible antigens you can think of. And this is the stem part. Well, we had done the key work in the middle 70s and then did not continue until 2000, despite the fact that little was known about the a major function of the antibodies, because when they are engaged with an antigen, they form complexes, and these complexes then bind to receptors on cells to trigger the cellular immune response. They are called Fc receptors because they obviously bind to the Fc part, but it was not known how. So the function of these Fc receptors, schematically you see here, there is an antigen covered with antibodies, and they bind to Fc receptors which are cell bound and trigger the immune response. This is complicated process, and I have no time to go into that because it must be a very carefully balanced process. There should be no overshoot. There should be a reaction, but not too much. And for that, you have different Fc receptors, one which is inhibitory and one which is activatory, and it's the balance between these two which keeps the immune response in check. So we wanted to know how antibodies bind to the Fc receptor. So we first looked at the structure of the Fc receptor and then of the complex. Well, this should also rotate. It shows that the Fc, as we knew, of course, is a symmetrical molecule consisting of two identical chains, but it binds only one receptor, so leading to some kind of asymmetry. So the when we had this structure in determined in 2000, we thought this may lead the way to a modulation of the immune response, because if we were able to prevent this interaction, we could inhibit the immune response, for instance, in the case of autoimmune diseases. So we thought of small molecules that might inhibit the contact, didn't find anything. And then we thought maybe the receptor itself may do it. So the simple idea was, again, we do have an antigen, we do have antibodies bound, and we have a soluble receptor, which we called SM101. And then this forms a complex which no longer can bind to the cellular receptor. So the idea was, in the case of an autoimmune disease where there is a massive amount of immune complexes activating the immune system, leading to inflammation, that by using soluble receptor we could make it more balanced. Not only using activated soluble receptor, but also using an antibody which specifically binds to the receptor. Again, this is a separate story, which also has been developed in this newly founded company. So there were animal data. So we founded a company in 2003, as I said. First did some animal experiments for models, animal models of autoimmune diseases, which looked wonderful, so wonderful that investors were found, which financed the company, because all of the work after 2003 was outside the academia, and again, without my involvement into operational business. This is the antibody story that was developed again with the help of some crystal structures. Then the work went beyond preclinical phase into phase one and phase two for certain immune, autoimmune diseases. One is thrombocytopenia and one is systemic lupus, which again looked promising in patients, so that investors stayed on board, although they were not very happy, yet they were patient enough for this to happen. This happened half a year ago, as I just said, that Big Pharma bought this company and in addition, the company will continue now under the label Baxter or Baxalta in Munich, so the team will stay together. But again, here are the major investors, which were very happy, including the lawyers and the Bruker. The founders were also happy simply because of the continuation of the operation in Munich and because of the now quite concrete hope that the idea that we had in 2000 comes into fruition under the umbrella of a big pharma. This is Munich. This is the university where Laue and Röntgen worked 100 years ago, and set into motion crystallography, protein crystallography, structural chemistry, and everything I told you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much once again, Professor Huber. Very inspiring, and I'm sure from cosmology that you see things in space to crystallography that you can see such a small thing in fantastic details. Give our plenary speaker a few moments for grabbing some water, and for those of you who are ready to ask questions, please slowly raise your hands, and Professor Huber, would you be so kind to pick someone to ask a question, please?
Please, yes.
Okay, whoever, go to the microphone first. Okay, where's the microphone? To Dr. Egasit. Okay, raise your hand higher, stand up. Okay, you give to someone for the first question.
Okay, Professor Emre from Turkey. Okay. And I would like
Can you speak louder? Louder.
Speak okay. up, please.
Is that okay? Can you hear me?
Okay. No, not really.
Okay. Okay. Emre from Turkey. And I would like to ask you when there is no any former experiment about your research, and how did you manage your experimental design? I mean, what are your ways to invent or design a technique? So thank you.
Well, the work is quite straightforward. If you are interested in a particular biological macromolecule, you first have to make it in pure form. That's what we usually do. And then the next step is crystallization. If you have crystals, then we do apply the crystallographic techniques. Now, I should say that this is often a stumbling block, that you have pure material, but it does not like to crystallize. There is a wonderful development of electron microscopy, which we face in the last 10 years or so, again, driven by method and instrument development, such that you can see large protein molecules at near atomic resolution in non-crystalline form by simply analyzing 100,000 or millions of individual particles. The problem there is to find the correct orientation so that you can average them. So a wonderful new development that we see right now. We are in the middle of it. And many crystallographers now work in parallel. They do electron microscopy and crystallography.
Okay, from this side. We switch from the left to the right.
Well, there are many questions. I'm happy, but I will be around today and tomorrow for questions that you cannot ask now. But go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Hien Sugoi. I'm from Cambodia, and today I have a question. Is that as the protein develop and they are so similar from protein to another different protein, they have their special structure and they can identify that protein. So how can researcher and scientists can identify that protein different from another protein?
Well, this is actually quite simple because you do not even need a detailed structure determination, let's say by crystallography. You just can make an NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance spectrum, and compare the spectra and see whether they are identical or not. Now, in many cases, proteins are related but not identical, so they do have different NMR or optical spectra. Now, in that case, you have to make a detailed analysis. This is one point. The other point is that you often recognize when you compare amino acid or gene sequences that two proteins are related. This has become a quite powerful method because of the enormous amount of data that we have on protein and gene sequences you clearly recognize. But then, of course, you recognize the basic familiarity, the basic similarity, but you then would like to know more about the differences. And for that purpose, you do have to determine experimentally structures.
Oh. Thank you, Professor.
Go from that side. We go from that's you. Okay, you stand up, and then this gentleman.
Thank you, Professor Huber. I'm Jin Hong from Malaysia, and I'd like to ask that most of the virus proteins that infect the cells are self-assembling. So, are there ways that we can detect the conditions for the self-assembling proteins so that we can generalize the idea and shed some light for the mysterious protein folding step.
So this, if I understand you correctly, this would be a kind of antiviral agent if you can prevent the self-assembly in cells. Well, that's a good idea. I'm not aware of, but I'm not really familiar with the field that a drug has been found that works in this way, but certainly it is a possibility. If you prevent self-assembly, then the virus remains non-functional and is eventually degraded inside the cells.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for your lecture. I am Shubhabrata Chatterjee from India, and my question is that when we design specific protein molecules so as to inhibit certain disease-causing reactions, it becomes important to understand the effectivity of the molecules we designed so that side reactions could be controlled. So my question is, how do such challenges, how are those challenges tackled when it comes to maintaining a particular level of specificity?
You meant when you design a molecule that interacts with a specific target protein. That I think was your question. We do not design proteins, usually not, for that purpose. So there, of course, the major problem in drug design and drug development is to generate specificity for a particular target and to avoid binding to a related target. And most of the proteins, target proteins that we have, are members of a family. And we would like to avoid interaction with family members. So this is a major problem in drug design and drug development, and you can do, let's say, you can help by looking at the detailed atomic structures, you see, of two variants, and find out what why a particular compound binds to one and not the other. But there is heavy experimental work just in this direction in pharma design and pharma development. It's actually most of the work in developing a new drug to generate specificity and avoid toxicity, for instance.
Professor, I am Jong Yup Kim from South Korea. My question is that I am curious why there are so much ways of protein activity regulation. I wonder whether it is just some results of evolution or there is some special reason why there should be various ways of protease activity regulation.
Yes, this is an interesting question. Why are there so many ways? And the list I showed in one of the first slides, this cartoon, this is what we had found, but this is quite complete already in general. Why do we have that? Well, proteins are in quite different environments, inside, outside cells. They have often additional functions. They interact with other molecules, and therefore they need some special mechanisms. So also what is quite obvious that nature works with things that are already around, you see, and modifies them. So what is perhaps a non-inhibitor in the initial case is by some modifications becoming an inhibitor. I'm not sure whether I answered your questions, but I find it quite fascinating and quite natural that nature plays around with what it has, and if it achieves the function that it wants, namely the inhibition, the modulation of the function of a certain target protein, then it makes that perfect. But there are other ways, which are also then modified and made perfect. Now, nature is wonderful.
Thank you, Professor.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Shraddha from India. My question is related to the photosynthetic reaction center protein that you talked about in the beginning. So I have read earlier that the light reaction of photosynthesis happens in two photosystems, photosystem 1 and 2, so in the thylakoid membrane. So how does the photosynthetic reaction center protein play a role in this? And is it the same in both the photosystems or is it different?
Now first, the reaction center that we analyzed is, so to say, a primitive one. But it has all the essential protein and cofactor components, also concerning their structure, that we then later saw in the plant photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. So there are two subunits which hold the chlorophyll, where the primary process that is absorption of the excitation energy and ejection of an electron happens. This is like in the bacterial reaction center, it is exactly the same in photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. There are differences, of course, different additional proteins around, cofactors around, which modify the function of photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. But the basic element we saw in 1985 in the bacterial version.
My name is Ingrid from Thailand. Oh, I have a question to ask your Professor Huber. First, thank you for your special lecture. Okay. How can receptor recognize the enzyme for specific function in case of enzyme is protein, but what if there was a denature?
Did I understand correct? How can one make a specific enzyme from scratch? This is my dream. I don't know how to do it. I think it's the dream of many. Whether this will come true or not, I'm not sure. As there are no colleagues from the field around, I used to say, now my generation have proven that we cannot do it. We have failed. But the next generation maybe? You or your children? Well, it should be in principle possible. You see, nature has done it. However, in different ways by Darwinian selection, by selection and Darwinian evolution. This is difficult to do technically, but it is possible. So it should happen someday.
Thank you very much.
Good day, Professor Huber. I'm Clarissa from Malaysia. As mentioned, the protein folding process is not well studied yet. Currently, I would like to know, is there any technology in the crystallography field, such as real-time X-ray imaging, so we can see the structures during the folding process?
Well, we unfortunately cannot see these structures during the folding process. We see the endpoints. We see the folded structure. This is the functional structure. This we can crystallize. And we cannot see, but we can imagine how the completely unfolded structure looks like. It's a flexible chain. But there are intermediates, which are very difficult to see. Perhaps with the NMR experiments, you can do something if there is a more stable nucleus, which you see in the NMR spectrum. And of course, we can look what the computer says. Now, to believe what the computer says is up to you. I think the progress was quite good in the last 10 or 15 years, that we may hope that one day we can simulate the folding in atomic terms in the computer.
Is it a restriction of technology, or is it just a chance that we haven't got the opportunity to see it yet, or is it because of the compartmentalization of the cell?
Yeah, well, it's probably both. So you see a major progress in molecular simulation, molecular dynamics, was by the development of faster computers and faster algorithms. You see, but I mean, the question is there a basic new idea missing in all of these simulations? Is perhaps a basic interaction there that we haven't recognized yet? Or do we have to have completely novel, different ideas? Perhaps we need, I sometimes say, perhaps we need an Einstein of biology. If there is a basic idea missing, I am quite convinced that it will happen because it happens in nature, in our cells, and we should be able to simulate it sooner or later. But again, not the present generation of researchers. They have shown that they can't do it.
My name is Nantanik from Thailand. I would like to ask, is there a way to create inhibitors or proteases that can be activated by external stimuli, such as like electromagnetic waves or other things, and you can make a remote controlled kind of reaction in order to make like a specific drugs for specific locations or something like that?
Well, whenever there is a molecule in a defined state that you can isolate, you can look at its three-dimensional structure, and then you can design molecules that inhibit. I'm not sure what you had in mind or what you said, that there is modulation of enzyme structure and function by electromagnetic radiation. What did you say?
I mean, like using other kind of stimuli that are not chemical processes. Say you inject a medicine into a person, but you only want to activate it at a certain spot. So instead, you might send a stimuli at a certain spot that is not chemical, so that the protease may activate at a specific spot.
For these kind of things, structural biology and molecular research is the last step, actually, in that. If you inject something into a patient, what happens? And this is an extremely complex thing to do. So molecular biology is at the last step, would be the last step of it. But whenever you can define a certain state of a biological molecule isolated in a stable form, then you can analyze it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for that speech, Professor Huber. This is actually a question related to business rather than biology, but you talked about the valley of death and the gap between research and commercialization, and how the Max Planck Institute was working to bridge the gap. Has it always been this way?
I'm not sure whether I understood.
Yeah. So you talked about the valley of death, but the bridge, the gap between research and making a product.
Oh, right.
And I wanted to ask if it's always been this way, and what your ideal process would be from research to making a product.
Mm-hmm. Has it always been like that? At least in chemistry, I think the interaction between basic science and chemical industry was tighter, more intimate than it is now. There is a gap, and what to do to make the communication between these two sides better. Well, now let me tell you in how it was in my case with my research group, which began its work in the late 60s. I had a substantial number of doctoral students that did part of their PhD work in pharma industry, because we had a joint interest in a particular protein system. So we were interested in finding out the three-dimensional structure and function of, let's say, a kinase. And industry was working on the pharma aspect of that kinase. So how to bring that together? We exchanged students. So the students went to pharma industry, prepared the material, and then came back to the academic lab to crystallize it and to determine the structure. We then published jointly. So this happened in my case in many cases, actually, and it was a very fruitful collaboration. This is 40 years back, and I think it has become worse in the meantime. So this kind of intimate collaboration is seen very rarely, unfortunately. And that can be improved. There is often one obstacle that that industry would like to keep the project it works on secret. Of course, an academic lab has to publish. So to bring these two things together is not impossible, but there is some substantial resistance on the industry side. Then I had also for a while a industry group in my department. They occupied part of the laboratory, which was very difficult to legalize in that sense, because as an academic institution, we cannot be home for an industrial group. On the other hand, the industrial group also would like to control publication. But it finally, it worked. It was not illegal. It was legal. It was very fruitful. I think we had 20 or more joint publications on kinases. So this is this intimate kind of collaborations which I would like to see more often.
Thank you.
We could go on and on for a few more hours, but the last question is on attendee acid. Who's asking? Okay, you asked the last question.
Hello, Professor Huber. I'm a student from China. I find that current biology focuses on characteristics of molecules from which we can predict its structure. But we can only get to know something by experiments, especially by physical methods. But is it possible that one day people fully understand the secret of life and can know new protein molecules structure by theoretically analysis?
Well, this is what I would like to hope very much. I'm optimistic it will happen. It did not happen in my generation. It may happen in yours or in the next generation. Now, whether this is the solution of the question of life, I'm not sure. But it's an important part of the solution to know the structure and function of all of the constituents of a human body, of a human cell. And this can be achieved, quite sure. You see the enormous progress in gene sequencing. You could not have thought of that. So we know the genes, and then it's in some stage, we should know the function and structure of all the gene products in isolation. The next problem in the hierarchy of the next step in the hierarchy of problems is that we have thousands of gene products in cells which interact transiently. To understand this is as we are far away from that.
So how long do you think we need to achieve such a big change?
Well, I'm not sure whether I can answer that, but the first part, so the quite concretely expressed the prediction of structure from sequence. This would be the first step. This, I think, we can achieve at least for small and medium-sized proteins in your generation. Then come the large protein molecules, I don't know, one more generation. Or if there is an ingenious idea missing, an idea that will solve the problem in no time, that may be that we are just missing an interaction.
Thank you, Professor. We'll work hard. Thank you.
Thank you for your question as well. Thank you. And thank you, all of you, once again. And I myself enjoy all the questions. And there are a lot more questions, but please approach to Professor Huber. And one last thing. This is such a great moment, and I hope strongly that this will be a memorable moment in your life, that you get inspired, and I cannot think of anything else, but consider you all are very lucky. Give Professor Huber once again a big applause. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Palangpon. So I have a brief announcement to make. So we're going to have the cultural activity tomorrow, right? Tomorrow evening from 7 p.m. To 9 p.m. There'll be 8 activities that you are cordially invited to participate in. They are Thai garland making, lukchup cooking. Lukchup is a kind of Thai dessert. Kazawa Thai dessert cooking, indigo dyeing, lotus petal folding, bamboo fish weaving, Thai boxing, and lastly, Thai dancing, as you have seen yesterday. Since each activity will last about half an hour to 1 hour, so you cannot participate in all 8 activities, So you need to choose only two activities that you are really, really interested in. And there'll be sign-up sheets posted on a board in front of the cafeteria back at the SSH at the Science Home tonight. So please visit the board to see the information about each activity and sign up to any activity that you are interested in. Check the duration of each activity and make sure that you are not signing up for more than one activity at the same time. And Find Earth have some information about the camps.
Hi everyone, so now it's the break time, but before we go out for the break, I would like to give you some information about the camp. So after the break, it's gonna be a camp section, and for the camp, you all will be divided into four smaller groups so that you have more chance of like talking to the speakers. And the group, if you look on your name tag, it's gonna be separated based on the alphabet. So if you have the code start with A, that's mean you're in class A. And so on. And the location of the four classes are, for Camp A, it's gonna be 305. We are on the third floor right now, so 305 will be on this floor. Camp B is gonna be at 306. Camp C is gonna be at 404, so you have to go up one level. Camp D is gonna be at 405. I will repeat this again. Camp A is gonna be at 305. Camp B is at 306, Camp C is at 404, and Camp D is at 405.
We have snack provided outside this room. We also have separated table for the vegetarian and halal.
And please feel free to get some snacks outside, and we also have drinks outside as well. And if you have trouble finding the room, please feel free to ask any of the staff.